Hi guys, how you doing?
Hello, hey, I'm Keith.
And I'm Dell.
And we are Renjeaux and we listen to cool albums.
We do.
Dell, what are we listening to today?
We are listening to SimpleMinds, NewGoldDream.
Yeah, nice. I'm so looking forward to this, man. I've been listening to this album, since it came out, I guess. We got it. It was one of the first albums that we had. It was, it's been influential in my life for a long time.
This is the band.
I mean, it's been out for almost 40 years now.
This is the band, SimpleMinds, at that time. Promo picks for that. And I added the Mel Gaynor there. But first, you got Derek Forbes on bass, Charlie Burchill, part of the founding duo, on guitar, Mick McNeil on keyboards, Mike Oakletree came in on drums, Jim Kerr, the singer. But
he's the other founding member, right?
Mike Oakletree.
Jim Kerr and Charlie Burchill.
Yeah. Charlie Burchill, right. And Jim Kerr are the two. They're SimpleMinds.
Founding
members. Still with the band, still doing things as the band, yes. And I got Mel Gaynor in there because he actually played drums half or if not mostly on this album and ended up joining the band immediately afterwards and playing drums with them from there on out. So he's basically a part of the band on this album as well.
Awesome drummer.
Awesome drummer. Awesome drummer. And like you said, 1982. It was big time for us. This album came out and it just started doing this. Going, what the heck? What is this? Cool sound.
Yeah, great. Just cool sound, slick sound. I mean, the bass lines on this album are great. Cool guitar sounds, keyboards, just smooth. Jim Kerr's
texture on this just is
nonsensical lyrics.
Rich.
Texture, yeah, rich to velvety, slick, silky. We come home brilliant days. But from the very beginning, the bass lines on this album just got me. Just the bass sound, Derek Forbes, But then the keyboards, we've always been keyboard fans. That melody. And then Charlie playing that. I think the Edge stole this kind of rhythmic delayed picking guitar, kind of muted picking guitar sound from Charlie Burchill here.
This is Mel Gaynor playing drums here.
Yes. And then there's a girl's voice on this album. I mean, on this song, Sharon Campbell.
They're not hiding the drums, that's for sure. It's like out the
front. Yep, the snare comes in. The snare didn't come in until the chorus here. Keyboard melody. That's the keyboard and Jim Kerr playing it off each other. From note one of the album again. Yep.
That guitar, that doing the main melody there.
Yeah. It is.
That's another thing on this album. Sometimes the guitar and the keyboards, you really can't tell exactly which is which.
Yes, exactly. I love that. I always love that in bands when guitarists and keyboardists can complement each other, play with each other, play off each other. Once more see city lights. A lot of lights burning, golden city lights, candles, brilliant days. So it's light.
All imagery.
Yeah, So what is he saying? Who knows what he's saying, but the lyrics are beautiful. Shadows in brilliant ways will change me all the time. Somewhere there is someone.
It doesn't hit this thing.
That a million eyes can see. And somewhere there is someone. Who can see what I can't see.
Who can see what I can't see.
OB6 and our OB4, OB8.
And the bass is driving it, like you said.
Oh, yeah. Just love the bass. Yeah. I think that's what I always come back to the bass. I think it's what first got me, and still, when I listen to this, it's just those driving, cool bass melodies. You know,
so this is a fifth studio album by them. So they kind of developed into this whole I wouldn't call them a jam band, but they would just create these jams or create these songs off of these jam creations they would do, and Kerr would put lyrics over them, and they'd just kind of be this one steady. In fact, there's a few examples on this album where it's like that, where there's one steady stream going on, and they just kind of groove in and out of it with little different sections here and there.
Like that one, I think.
Yeah, but
yeah, I think, you know, between the verse and the chorus, there's not a lot of difference. Right. You know, I mean, the melody's different. There's a different keyboard part in there, but yeah, that groove, you know, the grooving of the bass, just like pumping the whole way through, you know, and just super steady, and you know, between him and, you know, all three drummers on this album, I thought did a good job. I'm glad they settled on Mel Gaynor, because he's just, especially in the next SimpleMinds album.
He shines.
Oh my God. Yeah, that's my favorite. We'll do that one at some point in the future. But this is a beautiful album. The next album is got a different feel, different sound, but
this album broke them out. This reached number 3 on the UK charts, and all, and this was like just a big, you know, big thing for them, for their album, just a breakout for them. Obviously, came out on Virgin. Go ahead.
Sorry. Well, so you said number 3 in the UK. Yeah. Did I get this right? It reached number 2 in the US.
I didn't see that. I'm not saying
you have that.
I didn't see that.
Anyway, it did. I know it went platinum in both countries.
Okay.
But I mean, I'm kind of surprised if it went to number 2 in the United States.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have that right.
No, I don't know.
So I know now that
on that note.
So this is one of my favorite songs on the album.
Now my Google tree actually
colors
plays Brian
Catherine. Right. Yeah. Which is cool. I like the open snare. It's like he turned off the snare on his snare drum, so he's more like a timbale sound. I like that open sound.
Never turn your back. Great times attack. And it turns the thrill. And I said, Bell, of all the friends who care, some should be seen, but never heard.
So this is another, the bass line is the same here on the chorus and the verse. But it's like great, I love that bass line. It's like he's thumbing it, you know, popping it.
Faithful keyboard chords working harmonies with his vocals.
Catch a boy, they're falling, falling in love, they're falling. Catch a boy, they're falling, falling in love, they're falling. Catch a boy.
Yeah. I like this. This is one of my favorite songs. Yeah, it's just got that cool groove. The bass line. Apparently, it's a story about jealousy.
Just for a guess. And I said, Bell, you turn them on.
Bell, you turn them on with your reflection. I know, so I think he's jealous that his girlfriend is, you know, raising pulses of other boys.
Colors,
colors fly, half a wheel. Poor girls cry in the beauty of both worlds.
So I've heard Catherine Will. David Byrne album called Catherine.
Oh, that's right.
There's a band called Catherine. So I looked up Catherine Will. Now originally, it's a torture. It's a torture gear back during Catherine the Great days. But I think this album, this song, refers to Colors Fly, which is. There's Catherine Will's used for fireworks displays. So that's what I get from this one. Colors Fly, yeah. And Catherine Will.
But he also just said, poor girls cry in the beauty of both worlds. I wonder if he's allusion to both of the kind of fun, lit up version.
And the torture.
Of the meaning of Catherine Will and the... He's torturing her, she's beautiful, but he's torturing her by flirting with other boys or something.
Only you, Keith.
Maybe, huh?
We bring those two worlds together, yes.
Jim Kerr, if you're listening out there, Kerr,
what the hell?
You care to validate my theory or not? You know, Jim Kerr's a big fan of ours.
Yeah. We'll find out.
I love the feel of this song. It's just a nice, cool groove. You know, and it's got thumping bass lines. Got a cool.
This is a perfect example where there's just a jam. It's just a jam that they're just jamming to. Right.
Yep. And the keyboard player and the guitar player kind of, and the singer, they're all kind of doing their thing above it, you know.
Right.
But the drums and the bass are keeping it steady, right? Rock steady.
So Burchill and Kerr have known each other since they were eight. 8 years old, and so they had this big, they had this just connection, and they had joined a punkish band. What was it? Do I have the name of it? I had the name of it. Maybe I don't have a name.
It's like the bad
boys
or something.
Johnny,
like that.
Johnny and the Self Abusers. That's what it was. I think two of the guys,
also known as the Bad Boys.
I think maybe Derek Forbes was in that band too. Or something like that. And so after a while, Jim and Charlie and Derek went one way and the other guys went the other way. And so they started doing their own thing and all that stuff. So yeah, those guys have been together for ages, for a long time.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and this,
this
album is produced by Peter Walsh at Townhouse Studios, which was a pretty big studios at the time. And you remember the manor, Oxford Manor,
Manor.
Richard Branson's place under Virgin. They recorded some of this there as
Is that
well.
What Oxford Manor
yeah.
is?
That's where XTC, that's where XTC did some things. And of course, Queen and all this stuff.
Yeah, a lot of.
But it's Peter Walsh did China Crisis, Difficult Shapes. You know that album.
Ah.
Produced
and Passive Rhythms.
He produced that. He produced Peter Gabriel Plays Live. I know you know that one. And even Kissing
Peter
the Pink,
who?
The one that says Certain Things Are Likely on it. He did that.
Oh.
Yep.
Wow. And all this these are Peter Walsh
productions.
Recordings that
productions.
You're listening here?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And Scott Walker. You've heard of Scott Walker, right? He's
the governor of Wisconsin.
No, he's kind of an influence of Mark Hollis and other people from. Like I hear a lot of comparisons between Mark Hollis from Talk Talk, and Scott Walker. He produced the Scott Walker album and Zymox. Anyway, that's Peter Walsh, the producer, on this album.
He's considerably older, I guess, in the top left photo there.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Cool. So this next song, Promise You a Miracle, has a different drummer altogether. It actually came up with the whole rhythm on this thing. His name is Kenny Hyslop.
Yeah. He sounds familiar. I think he must be a session player or something. Because I think I've seen him in other...
Promise to a miracle. Belief is a beauty thing.
Belief is a beauty thing.
That riff is inspired by like a funky horn thing that this Kenny Hyslop had brought in.
Yeah. Ah, really? This was the first single. Only love. Released a few months before the album.
It's kind of like a transition, I think, from their older stuff into this. They're trying to actually create a single.
Pretty catchy.
Yeah.
Well, they had a really successful tour of Australia.
Oh yeah.
With the Ice House.
Yeah, I remember the tour that.
And they were feeling on top of the world, and upon returning to Europe, this was the first thing they did. And it,
I promised you a miracle.
Yeah, I mean, super catchy. This was they played this on the radio in Corpus a little bit.
Yeah, you're right.
So this one, the bass player actually has a different bass line for the chorus and the verse.
Yeah,
but they're still both thumping, you know?
This is their adventure into writing pop songs. Oh, I love that little beer.
Yeah, exactly. Got that little bass lick. Goes off. This is as close as Charlie Burchill gets to a lead, I think, right?
Yeah,
here.
Probably so.
I kind of like the edge.
Really good keyboardist on this. Only it's
for love. I've always liked him. Yeah, his style is. Textural, nice little melodies.
Bad tasteful pads.
Really smooth sounds. He chooses smooth sounds. Even when they're plucky, they're smooth.
But there's really nice pads.
Yeah, and Charlie's.
We haven't even talked about Kerr's vocals at all.
Well,
it's kind of a part of the texture, but
well, yeah, especially right here, he's mixed, got in the mix just like another instrument, you know? And the fact that his lyrics are really
images?
Yeah. More, you know, I think he chooses lyrics for their rhythm and their phrasing and the singability, you know, not necessarily. I think especially, I thought I read something about where he said, especially on this album, that he was really just going for feeling and texture and, you know, and not meaning, you know.
Hmm. Yeah.
So, yeah, that's a cool song. That's a cool song. I always liked that song. I think it might have been the first time I heard Simple Minds, or at least was aware that this song, you know, any particular music was Simple Minds. So yeah, because, you know, I go back and listen to some of the previous albums. I didn't know any of those songs, so I think that was the first song of theirs.
So where did you go?
This is another jam, but this is Mel Gaynor on drums.
What are you doing with the bass?
No, Peter Walsh is actually the guy that brought in Gaynor to play.
Yeah, I think Gaynor would have been a session musician for Peter Walsh.
So where did you go?
For some reason, he wasn't a too big of a fan of Mike Ogletree.
Yeah. Gaynor there on the right. He stuck with them the rest of the way. At least for all that he didn't play with them now, but most of their big time.
We were on the top, I know what was right. We were on the dock of the world of warning.
The Big Sleep, I think it's just. I think he's talking about death. Either death or heroin.
Well. Band had a reputation for not doing drugs.
Yeah. Well, apparently,
I'm adamant about being clean.
You know, vegetarian and everything. And that's kind of ironic because I really, especially this album, I think I listened to it several times when I was on X back in the day. And it was a really good. It was a really good experience.
Not that you're rapping to me.
But, yeah.
But you're
going out in the Big Sleep.
You know, he kind of reminds me of
Stumping.
He has a little bit of Paul Webb, early Talk.
Yes.
Era bass.
That's true. That first Talk album, especially, huh? Sounds like he's got a chorus pedal on his stomping it. So he's got that from the pop, and he's got that smooth chorus bass sound.
Sometimes he has this kind of talk singing thing going on. Always melodic. Just throwing things out there.
Yeah, exactly.
Not under this, not under control.
Bass lick right
there. Well, I love that.
Bass lick here. Couple of different lines, or is that, it might be an overdub. I think he's got a couple of different guitar parts.
Well, the main thing is the keyboard.
Yeah, a little arpeggio. Yeah, a little arpeggio for a little thing. Singing reminds me of David Byrne for some reason.
Oh.
All right, you know, the way Byrne is, it almost seems out of control sometimes.
Yeah.
You know? Right?
On the edge of control.
Yeah. Such a beautiful sound. He's so far mixed back, you know. How long did they, this one fades out, how long did they play it, you know?
Right.
I mean, they could have played this for 10 minutes, you know?
after a while, the tape operator's going, okay, all right.
Maybe so. Okay, hey guys, I'm Bandit here, okay? I get the picture. The
tape's about to run out.
Or maybe the tape did run out and they had to fade it right there, you know?
You mentioned the Edge. Yeah, I did see a note where this album was a big influence on Unforgettable Fire album, for sure.
I think Bono said that, wasn't it?
It might have been Bono saying that.
So I think that Bono got some of his kind of crooning, wailing off maybe from Jim Kerr here, you know. And they're, you know, both, SimpleMinds is Scottish and U2 is Irish. I was going to say they were both Scottish, but.
So back in that era, about every album we listened to that had, you know, your traditional band with singing and all that stuff, they would usually put one of these instrumental tracks on there. And this was actually one of my favorites of all.
Likes you.
I don't know if I ever made a compilation of all these instrumental tracks on these albums, but I meant to, and this would have been on it. But I really like the way this one sounds. It's real.
Yeah, what is the bass player doing? Or is it the guitar that's going down, 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 down? I think it's the bass. Yeah, that's the bass player. I don't think Charlie's come in yet.
This is that Mike Ogletree again. He's got that same snare sound that you were liking on the
Catherine. Yeah, the kind of that open snare timbali right. Sound. There's Charlie coming in right there.
Yeah.
And the bass, the fretless on this one, fretless bass. And then a little flute or something. So Mick McNeil did a lot on this. Square wave chords here. They got a few different parts. This is like the C section of this song already. That's his lead, right? he's such a textural guitar player, man, for sure.
Yep. I was looking for a comparison.
I compare him to the Edge, and also I think Fix, Jamie Westover. Yeah. You
know? It's much rounded edges.
Yeah. Those guys are both a little more rhythmic. Well, this one, he's all atmosphere. Right. You know, maybe that little flute right there. Might have been guitar. I like this part of it, yeah. I like the main melody is the keyboard. Playing really well with him.
Real nice, tasteful hi-hat for vocal treatment. Nice, tasteful hi-hats.
Right. Crash right there. Yeah. I never noticed that. The last kind of tag here at the end, I think.
a guitar.
Yeah, he's all over it now. What's he doing? He's like, just making some noise. Fat synth bass or something in there. And then Derek Forbes whopping that fretless.
Yeah, that's a sweet instrumental, man.
Yeah. It is. You know, I'm gonna bump that one up a half a star, man. Yeah, I like that one. That's an interesting one where they're just doing all sorts of stuff. And you know, I bet Jim Kerr could have been humming in the background or something too.
Right.
You know, kind of maybe just sitting on one of the amps or something.
But it set this up
making sounds.
Really nicely.
Ooh, God, I love this one.
This is the track.
Again, chugging bass.
This is the track.
And the keyboard. Yeah.
This is my 100 on this one.
Well, I mean, look at the album cover. Yeah, this sound and that album cover. And the cool thing about, I thought, you know, our album cover there is pretty nice. But the real album cover is metallic, shiny.
Yeah.
Like the gold, you know, where NewGoldDream was actually printed in gold ink, so it was metallic and, you know, reflective. And and you remember the record? I had the vinyl.
Yeah.
It was yellow and purple, kind of marble.
I had a photo of that. I was gonna put on this. I forgot.
They did the packaging really well, man.
This is Gaynor again on drums.
Right. Well, yeah, the whole second album is Mel Gaynor. The whole second side is Mel Gaynor.
I do like Kerr's vocals in this song.
Yeah, this is a good one to sing along.
There's a lead.
Here we go. Yes. You're right.
There's no lead section.
Here we go. Oh no, I keep waiting for him to go 81, 82, 83, 84. I'm gonna sing it again. And when you dream, dreaming the dream of me. Here we go.
81, 82, 83, 84.
Apparently, they signed a 4-year deal, a record deal, and those were the 4 years that the. So they got back from that tour from Australia and they were feeling it, you know. They just got a new record contract, you know. It's a shiny, bright new things, man. They got a positive outlook. Things are looking up for them, man. I love the melody here. The keyboard.
Good low register.
He does. He's that Jim Morrison kind of voice.
Right.
Right? That baritone.
Yeah. Never thought of that.
What is guitar here?
That's keyboard.
What's Charlie doing?
Keyboard.
love this sound. It's just such a sweet, just a great groove. All the parts coming out, all the textures and melodies. And the Jim is wailing, crooning back there, you know. Drummer and bass player just holding down that cool groove. I mean, they played this one out too. I wonder how long they played this one, you know. Could have gone another 5 minutes. Cool song, man. Great title track. It's great title track. It really captures the feeling. Early trance music is what I call this. Right? Yeah. You know, trance is in when you go to the, you know, it's now a kind of electronic genre.
Yeah.
But one of the things about that genre of trance electronic music is this kind of get this groove going, and then it's just this positive thing, and you're just like, you're just like the whole time. Yeah, just like you could dance for hours to it or whatever. And that's kind of what I get from so much of this.
And again,
album.
They probably play this until the tape ran out.
Yeah. And the tape operator's just sitting there going, okay, let's just let them keep playing. Don't tell them. Just let them play.
Until the tape runs out.
Totally. And
until the
tape operator
goes crashing.
I bet the tape operator's not even paying attention. He's in the control room jamming, you know, dancing along with them. Finally, he looks up and notices that, you know, the reel's going and the tape's all flopping. And you know, oh, hold on, guy. Okay, we're done.
And the engineer breaks.
And the tape goes flopping
all around.
All around the reel.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh, I love it.
That song
a great
is
picture.
Great.
Okay.
I never could. I mean, there's that song is just all like, I mean, that whole back section. She is your friend. New Gold Dream. Until the ocean breaks. Until the world goes hot. And until the city takes.
You know, take, yeah. And the beat goes crashing.
Just over and over
way.
Again.
Yeah,
all those things. Just
those pictures. Yeah, these snapshots,
right?
Of just like this dynamic, you know, the natural world is going, the waves are crashing, the cities are taking, whatever
burning,
that means.
Burning bridge and ecstasy yeah. worldwide on the widest screen. Just here, yeah. This is your world.
Burning bridge
this
and ecstasy, crashing beats.
All imagery of
crashing beats and fantasy, totally. Right. Yeah, it's just. Yeah, they got it all right on that song, man. You know, I'm going to bump that one up
that was,
another half star.
That song actually kind of leaned into a little bit of the imagery you'd get on the next album. Where am I blanking out? You know.
Yeah, I know. I know. I was trying to remember the name of that album earlier, and I'm like, okay. But yes, the next album, which, yeah, my favorite album there is this is a strong second for sure. Now, this next song, Glittering Prize, it's always been my favorite song on the album.
Really?
Just a favorite of my life. Yeah, a positive feeling. You know, it's got all the different parts. Look at this bass line here.
Yeah. Mel Gaynor again on drums. This was a single, too.
Yeah. Exactly. This is a second single. Released just a month before the album, in August 82. So I know I heard this on the radio, and I knew this was SimpleMinds. This is the song, well, okay, now this is another one of the, you know, the first two that they wrote right after that tour, that really successful tour of Australia with Ice House.
Yeah.
I love the bubbly keyboard sound.
Yeah.
Great sound. And this melody here. That's the bridge. Great melody here.
We were spending time. We were staring out.
I
surprise, I saw you up on a clear day. First a king heart, then a last breath away.
Yeah, great melody. I mean, this is a sing-alongable one, you know? And that, the girl singing. Clear day.
Oh. Only on a clear day. That's like...
What's her name, Campbell?
Sharon Campbell.
On the next album, they had a girl singer. It was different. Well, it might be in this girl, I guess. But like Sweet Your Love to Me had a great girl singing.
Yeah.
First it came off, then our last breath away. See it in the eyes, not the lights gone. We were spending time, we were staring out. Taking to the road, and it was breath from the moon. He was staring out, now we're staring in. Could you ever be, ever know that one?
Can you never stop?
Shine on, shine a light on me. In all of my life, so that much more I see.
Just that bass line.
Like a glittering prize, I saw you just, yeah. On a clear
I love this song.
Day. First it came hard, then a lot break away. Only on a clear
have a little bit of that Promise You a Miracle type flair to it.
That positivity, yeah. It's Promise You a Miracle is a little more rocking,
yeah.
But this is a, this is just a happy kind of, yeah, this is a clear day, afternoon, sunny day. We're walking through the streets, playing with our kids, you know.
Hook up with Chrissy Hynde. Is that after this?
He what?
When did he hook up with Chrissy Hynde? Is that after this?
Oh, maybe so. They did hook up. Are they still?
No.
Are they still together?
Oh, no.
They
oh,
were.
No, they're not. No.
No,
they had a
they
kid
were.
Together. In fact, I don't get that connection. To me, she's like, she's punk, really, relative to Jim. Jim's like, smooth, you know.
Well, they were kind of punk, weren't they? Sort of in the late 70s, maybe.
SimpleMinds,
right?
I don't. Maybe, yeah, they came out of the punk thing. I mean, I guess I get it. I don't know. I just didn't see her.
I think pop stars. I think back then, you know, back then there was so few. You know, these days. We have a genre a day, right?
Yeah.
But back then it was pretty much, you know, they would play anything on the radio, right? You could hear Kenny Rogers next to Simple Minds or whatever. And, you know, and so they were pop stars and they were both kind of new artists, I guess, even though, especially Simple Minds had been around since, what, 75
right.
or something? 76.
So we haven't done this for a while. I found a live version from this era of this next song, Hunter and the Hunted. I thought I would throw out there.
Cool.
If I might.
So we're gonna have a Mel Gaynor live. Herbie Hancock plays this keyboard solo on this on the album.
I think Mel is on this. Yeah. This is in Manchester. 1982.
Okay.
Here's Derek Forbes there.
Oh,
much as he's on it on the album, you know? It sounds good. It sounds like real lush and rich and like the album.
Here's what we miss in this version. I know it's Herbie Hancock played a solo on this song on the album.
I've never been able to pick out that solo.
Me either.
Though.
Lyric here is Kyoto in the snow. Only with me, first time. Heaven's calling me. Here's Kyoto in the snow. City of Kyoto.
Beautiful. Kyoto, the old capital of Japan.
All about this imagery. Takes things on and everything.
He's a good front man.
Yeah, definitely.
He's and they've always been a live band, so it was cool to see that. Thanks for showing me that, man. I hadn't seen that before. So.
Yeah, I just, you know, we didn't see them back then. I was always kind of curious. I'd seen some things from Sparkle in the Rain, the album afterward. I've seen some live stuff from that, but never from this era, so I was kind of curious. And that was actually one of the best sounding ones I found. So let's.
That was pretty cool. I mean, pretty cool. Thank you. Yeah.
So here's a song I don't understand at all. Maybe you can explain
it. Roland CR78. It's seems to me the lyrics are about American TV and media, colonialism, how the king is white. That's a very American, the white American culture, and push it out into the crowd and make everybody Americans all over the world. But this one totally sounds like Talking Heads' Drugs, the last song on Talking Heads' Fear Music album. Dark, right. Moody.
Especially that keyboard little.
And the bass.
Yeah.
The tempo. It's dark. Meditative. Not quite as trippy as Drugs, but really moody.
Again, I'm having a hard time. Guitar from keyboards. I love this. Let's keep it. Guitar.
And Charlie's playing a little chick, 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 chick. Rhythm. Yeah. Based.
Yeah, for a band that didn't do drugs, this sounds like a drug song.
It does, right? Talking Heads' Drugs, man.
Yeah, this could fit today. These lyrics could fit today easily.
Yeah. Youth dance proud from the waist down.
Yep.
Film of him, King is wide and in the crowd. That's America's and everybody's crowd.
Yeah, his vocals are not up front, ever. Just a part of the texture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even when he's screaming, you know, It's a part of the transition that everybody else is doing, you know?
Right.
Yeah. He's got echo on his voice just like the guitar does, you know? Yeah.
Mel Gaynor's toms. These are my favorite toms sounds.
He just now stepped it up, too, right there, right? And he's pretty been laid back the whole song. And now he stops back again. Shot from where the action is, Rhapsody in Black and Blue. She puts on the film of him, King is White. Love lies under Western eyes. Hopefully it transcends. Western eyes is America. David Byrne singing in Drugs, you know? Just kind of.
Bam. big sound, man.
That is a big snare sound right there, for sure.
Like snare and tom.
Charlie's doing it. And Jim is screaming too. Flavor of what of how Mel Gaynor whacked the drums like he does in Sparkle in the Rain on that album. He does more than jamming on Sparkle in the Rain.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I got
it's more of a rock album. Yeah.
I got parts on that album that I just hold my breath for when he plays drums.
Oh, man. Oh, my. Yeah, just thundering drums on that album. Steve Lillywhite produced that album, I'm pretty sure. Yeah, so.
I thought it was odd that they ended with this. That's kind of what I thought. This is an odd song for an ender for me. I usually like something I can really take with me for a last song, and I couldn't do it with that one.
I remember I do. I get that feeling of just darkness. Kind of this. They're kind of closing the door on the album. You know, it's not a. You know, we're coming on to do what is it when you do a live, you finish the concert and you come back, what is it called?
Finale,
encore?
Yeah.
You know, it's
yeah,
not like encore, they come on to do a jam and encore, you know, and it's more like, okay, we're fading out the live album. I mean, the live show, we're going to kind of slowly dim the lights, you know? It is a little, it's not one of my favorite songs on the album.
I just thought, I mean, I could see him. I get the atmosphere of it. I really do. I just thought.
That's what it is.
Okay, there's that. Now we go to the last song.
Right, yeah. That could be a good ender for side one, maybe, of the album. Right. But maybe not the whole. Right. Yeah.
But that's my, you know, for otherwise really good album. I mean, this had a solid B, solid 80 score for album, which is good for my end and everything. I just, you know, we've already complained about things we should they should leave it up to us to sequence, you know.
I know these people, they should listen to us about how they're sequencing their songs and albums and stuff, right? Again, we were in high school. All you had to do was call us up, Jim, and you know, Greg and Portland
album
High School.
Album sequence consultants.
Right. Well, dude, that was a fun album. Yeah. You know, that is an album. It made a big impression on me back in the day.
I played the hell out of this.
In our own music. Yeah, in our own music. I love synthesizers, and I've always gone for that lush synthesizer sound. And this is one of the first, really stellar examples of how beautiful and lush just keyboard synths can be, you know?
So very tasteful. Yeah. I remember the atmosphere of it, the details of it. I get to pick out now and going, it was all, everything was tasteful. You know, and that keyboardist was a big part of the keyboardist, and the fact that the guitarist was a big part, you know, the main part of the band and everything, and him working with the keyboardist and all that stuff. And then that bass just driving it. I never thought of it that way like you have. It's like the bass really did drive a lot of this album. The bass and that you hear that kick come in on somewhere, you know, someone somewhere in the summertime through that whole album, that kick is just bam, you know, just
in your face, just like solid. And no matter who the drummer was, that kick drum was always right there through the whole album.
So yeah, so it kicked my ass.
It did. It was such a, but it was a smooth kick, yeah. Man. You enjoyed every second of it because it's like, ooh, yeah, my butt's moving, you know?
Well, if so next.
What's next, Del? What's the
next
cool
time
we
come back over
next?
over the pond, back to Boston. And
Boston,
yeah,
Mary said this is such an American album. And you know, I it's not one of my favorite Cars albums, but it's, you know, it's up. It's a
I
good
like
one.
It better than I remembered, you know, checking it out now and yes. Everything. It's pretty sweet.
There's some cool creative and definitely some fun stuff yep. on this album. Yep. So, yep. We ought to have a good time. That one.
All right, Keith.
So,
man.
Thanks for joining us again. I am... No, wait. He is Del.
And he is Keith.
And we are Renjeaux, and we listen to cool albums. We're going to see you next time, okay?
I think so.
We love you.
Bye.